Welcome back friends, I hope everyone is doing great. And in this video, this is the second part. Like we have already shared one of the first part of Java interview question and answers. So this is especially for experienced people, like what kind of questions they will encounter. And these questions that I am going to share you right now will be definitely you will encounter in almost all your interview questions, almost all interview processes. So let us start. First question, like this is not the second part, first question: what will happen if an exception is thrown from the finally block? So what will happen? So if an exception is thrown from the finally block, like if at all we are not handling from that, the program will exit, or else the exception propagates out and up and will be handled at the higher level. Finally block will not be completed beyond the point where the exception is thrown. And if the finally block was executing during the handling of an earlier exception, then the first exception is lost. This is one important point you need to know. Like if at all there is try, catch, and finally, in the try block, there suppose there was one exception that got raised, saying suppose a exception got raised, and in the finally block, when you were executing some when you were closing something, b exception got raised. So now when you throw an exception, like when the exception gets traversed, the a exception will be suppressed here and the b exception will traverse back. So that is one important point that needs to be noted down here. Next question is, what is it better to use, Hibernate or any JRORM than JDBC for database interaction in various Java application? Like why it is, you know, easy, or why it is better to use Hibernate or any ORM in that perspective over JDBC? So what is the benefit that we get using Hibernate? So Hibernate is, or any other ORM provider, ORM framework provides OO, object oriented view of the database by mapping the various classes to the database tables. This helps in thinking in terms of object oriented language than in RDBMS terms, and hence increases productivity. So basically here we just need to concentrate on our own logic and not on the not on writing the coding part. Just we need to take care of the correct mapping and everything will work fine. So like irrespective of the DB that we are using, any ORM framework will generate its respective DB queries and will execute. That is the benefit that we get of ORM framework. Next question is, what is the purpose of intern method in string class? This is one of the important interview question, like especially for the people of 2 to 4 years of experience range. So if like most of the time this question is asked for them. So Java string intern method is used for getting the string from the memory if it is already present. This method ensures that all the same string shares the same memory. For example, create a string hello 10 times using intern method would ensure that there will be only one instance of hello in the memory and all the 10 references point to the same instance. So basically this is the answer for this. So, and this is one of the important question as well. Next question is, can we declare constructor as private? If yes, where you can use it in your application or project? So yes, we can declare constructor as private, especially like whenever I face this interview, currently at that time, what the scenario that strikes the mind is singleton. So in singleton we have private constructor, and using the getInstant static method we initialize that constructor. So coming to the scenario where I have used constructor is, we were asked to create a service, and that service was to be a singleton class. So in that scenario we have used a private constructor. Can you make a constructor final? One of the tricky interview question, I would say this is for any experienced guy. Private definitely we can do. Can we do a final? Like firstly, what is final? We need to understand it. So final, basically we cannot subclass it, we cannot override final methods, final constants we cannot change. So constructor, coming to constructor, so overriding thing comes into picture when we are extending the class. So if we are extending a class, constructor doesn't get inherited. So even if you write final, that is of no use. So Java will not allow us to write a final, so that we cannot have a final keyword in with constructor. Like final and constructor cannot go hand in hand. It is a compile time exception itself. Like modifier final is not allowed will be the exception that will be throwing by the IDE. Next question, what is the use of transient keyword? This is one of the important question, I would say again, and one of the important keyword as well, because using transient keyword, we will restrict few variables from getting from taking part from serialization. So if at all you want to restrict some what I can say variables not to take part in the serialization thing, so we need to use transient keyword with that variables. So like basically there are scenarios like where we where it is unethical to serialize some specific data. Like if you take in a healthcare industry PHI, there is something called personal health information data that you cannot serialize. In that scenarios, what all things like we can use this transient keyword and we can stop those values from getting serialized. Next question is, what will happen if you call return statement or system.exit in try or catch block will finally block execute? One more interview, tricky interview question. Like I used to get confused a lot of time in the earlier state. So basically, when you do system.exit, finally block won't get executed. And if you are returning a statement, if you are returning something from the try block, then finally block will definitely get executed. So in Java, the finally block will execute even if you put return statement in try block or catch block, but finally block won't return if you call system.exit from try or catch block. So that is the answer. Next question is, why is thread stop deprecated? This is important question again. I would say like to know whether you understand the things or how deep you understand threading, multi-threading, this question will be asked. Yeah, this is a deprecated method, but why? Because it is inherently unsafe. Stopping a thread causes it to unlock all the monitors that it has locked. If any of the objects previously protected by these monitors were in the inconsistent state, other threads may now view these objects in an inconsistent state, such as objects are said to be damaged. Such objects are said to be damaged, and when threads operate on damaged objects, arbitrary behavior can result. This behavior may result to stubble and difficult to detect. Thread death exception kills thread silently, thus the user has no warning that what program may be corrupted. So that is the issue with thread dot stop method. Coming to the next question, what is the difference between class dot furname and class dot furname dot new instance method? So let us take one example and explain this. So basically, when we do, if we see the example, I've taken a demo class, there is a constructor, there is a main method, and inside the main method, first line is class dot furname of demo, which returns a class of type, and then again class dot new instance, we are typecasting it to demo class. So this is the explanation is here is like class dot furname returns a class object associated with the class or interface with the given string name, then calling class dot like new instance creates a new instance of the class represented by the class object. This is this class is instantiated as if we are writing new keyword and we are creating an object. That is the same thing that happens here. One more important question, that is, what is the difference between heap and stack? This is one of the important interview questions for irrespective of your experience. So here are few list that I could find it out. So heap is used to store objects like objects created anywhere in the class inside method or in any block of code. So those are stored in heap. Only exception is that string literals, which are stored mainly in the permgem area until like Java 7, they used to get stored there. So stack space is used to store local variables, methods, frames and constructs. Heap space in Java is much bigger than stack space. Obviously heap space is shared by thread differences, but each thread has its own stack space again, and any local variables created in the thread are not visible to other threads. We can resize heap space using the command -xms and -xms to specify the start and maximum heap memory in Java. Similarly, we can use -xss to specify stack size of individual threads in JVM. Order, like in there is no order that gets maintained in the heap, but stack follows LIFO, like last in first out order. That is why when we can use recursion in Java, like and in Java, like if at all heap gets filled, we get a heap out of memory error exception. When stack gets filled, we get stack overflow exception or error. Sorry, coming to the next question, this is the last question. So this is the last question. I hope you like this video, so please do like, provide your feedback. There are a few other questions that we'll be sharing as part of the other videos, as this video is getting long. So dividing it into bits and pieces.